Hello. Good afternoon, guys. Thanks for the intro. How many of you are experienced Android developers? Not bad. So I was actually looking for people who don't have experience who are probably at this session. So how many of you are new? I'm assuming the rest of you are new.
Hello?
Okay, so how many of you have had problems with UI or are still having problems with UI? That's a lot of people. So, okay, first things first, I'll be talking mostly on the UI side. So what I won't be beating up again is fragments. So I'm because every other person kind of says fragments is fragments. So I'll be on a more on the UI side and XML, let me put it the other. Okay, so you already know who I am. I'm an Android developer slash project manager at techgenie.com. So if I had known this as an introduction, I'd probably not have this slide. I'm also the creative head behind the BLR-Droid logos. How many of you know what BLR-Droid or Bangalore Android user group is? So the rest of you who don't know, I would request you to join the group. So also, I'm guessing the rest of you have not have seen the logos, right? Here are the two logos. The one on the left is actually the older logo, and we decided to make a new one. If you don't like it, do let me know, because that'll probably require fixes. If you like it, it's good enough, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to have like various steps as to what you need to do to make sure UI runs on. Okay, I need to make sure I don't walk into this. Yeah. So, runs on all screen sizes. And since we're all nerds and geeks here, I'm going to start with step zero. So, step zero is basically understanding the Android platform when it comes to UI. So, the Android platform, as you know, it's open source. Once you open source something, you get various options with it. And another example being the WebKit engine. You have one open source engine which runs two different browsers, and probably many more. So, like, Android is divided, like the Android phones, rather devices, because now we have tablets, are divided by, you can divide them by screen sizes, screen density, orientation, and resolution. So screen size is basically the diamond screen size. Like I have a HTC Desire HD, which I think is 4.3. I've been wanting so many phones, I forgot my own screen size. So, and screen density is basically the number of pixels in your screens. So when the iPhone came out, they came out with a Retina display, which had like, I think 330 pixels per inch, which is pretty high when compared to everything else. So that's basically it tells you how much number of pixels per inch. So the Retina display is packed with pixels, which is why it gives a richer display. There are many more displays now, like the Galaxy Nexus is very close to Retina. Then we have orientation of the phone. Now, one thing, actually it's coming to my next slide, but I'll just, make sure the phones are divided into different orientations. Phones are usually in portrait, tablets are all in landscape, but the default orientation for the tablet is landscape. So if you decide to kind of have a workaround for your UI by deciding I'm going to support only portrait, your app will look weird on the tablet, to say the least. Resolution is, do I need to tell you guys what the resolution is? Okay, so, but one important thing is, now, since the phones, you can divide devices into all these categories, you can have phones that look the same, but have different, they can have different resolutions, they can have different screen densities. So, there's a Samsung phone with a flip out, that one's screen resolution is 240-400, whereas the same size portrait phone actually has a higher resolution. My old phone, the Spica, had only a 3.2 inch screen, but its resolution was 320-480, which is actually, so basically your screen density in that phone was higher. Okay, so which what I was saying in my previous slide. So the first thing you need to realize when you're building UIs, don't keep yourself in one frame of mind. Now, the phones are not always that. Now, what icon, what does that icon represent? Good morning, people. Camera? I was hoping for the iPhone answer. Maybe the green kind of took it off, I guess. So no, basically, when you see this, you kind of, I think Apple patented or they have copyright issues if you do something like this. I'm not sure. But your phones can be in different screens and sizes. Most of you carry phones which are like candy bar shaped, so their default is portrait. Then there are phones like a Motorola Flip Out and the Blink 2. The girls might know Blink 2. I don't know if you've tried it. I forgot the company. So those are square phones. So whichever way you rotate the phone, you're still left with a square orientation. So there your landscape and portrait are the same, right? And then you have tablets, where the hardware keys are defined in such a way that the tablet is supposed to be used in a landscape mode. So as I said previously, if you define your app to only run in a portrait mode, your app will look sideways, and the user will have to like turn his phone around. So that breaks continuity, right? You should not probably do that. And the other thing you really need to do is always have a plan for different orientations. You can change your screens. You can have your buttons or your layout defined in one method in a portrait, and you can totally change it for the other thing. And don't think of, it's supposed to be a mathematical equation, but don't think of landscape as a portrait which has more width and less height. It's not that. You can totally change it. Like, just 3 days ago, I was working on a project in office, right? So we realized that when we changed it to a portrait, half of our components were missing because we required the rest of the components to be always visible. So what we decided to do is, the app has a header bar, action bar, header bar, whatever. It's not actually an action bar because you can't remove the action bar. But we decided to remove the header bar. And there are other apps which decide to show you only important data when you turn to landscape. You can probably do that too. So yeah, always have a plan. Yeah, so once you have a plan, start letting Android know of your plans. The first thing you need to know, tell Android is your app is going to be supported on all screens. That is done by, in a manifest, you have to put in the support screen tag, and you let it know that you're going to support small screens, normal screens, extra large screens. So extra large screens are tablets, right? So if I'm correct, I don't remember it right, but Android kind of uses this to actually limit your app in the market, am I right? Yeah. So if you want your app to be available on every device, you actually have to use all the screens. So this I learned, so whatever I'm telling you, I learned by experience. So I learned this when one of our client came back and told us that this app is not visible on the market for my tablet. So we kind of were beating our head and trying to figure out why it was. So this was the solution actually. Yeah. So how many of you know about resource sets? Everybody will know LDPI, MDPI, HDPI. How many of you know you can actually use it in layouts? There are various ways you can define your resource sets. You can actually have your layouts, you can specify layout for landscape, you can specify layout for portrait, you can go, you can club all the things too. You can have a layout, you can have folders, like you can have a layout landscape HDPI, you can have layout dash portrait slash MDPI. So basically you can tell Android that, okay, if the phone is like this, it can be very specific. If the phone is a HDPI phone and it's in portrait mode, use these resources. So basically the point coming, what I'm trying to say here is, you need to have different resources. I'm trying to think of a good example. I don't think of examples before giving talk, I should do that. But let's say, how many of you use buttons, images for buttons? So you give three different button sizes, right? Nobody gives three different button sizes? Yeah, I'll be coming to 9 patches. Yeah. So you can't use, of course, you can't use 9 patches everywhere. So sometimes you just, let's say you're doing a contacts app and you feel very nice about yourself. So you decide to give your contact to every person who installs your app. So you need your own photograph, right? So you'll have to give three different photographs. So I've gone to another event sometime back, and these were college students, right? So they didn't understand this. So I kind of lied to them, and I told them, let's say you're making an app which displays an image of Katrina Kaif. Of course, all the guys started laughing. More like blushing, I guess. So if you provide only one resolution of image of Katrina Kaif, and which is supported on, let's say it's supported on one screen, If you change your screens, either Katrina Kaif is surrounded by white space, or you're seeing only a part of an image, or you're seeing a very small Katrina Kaif. Of course, I got laughter there, none here. The other thing you need to start handling is orientation changes. How many of you handle orientation changes? Either way, manually or let it handle. Okay, I guess you're too late. I'm kind of lost now. So those of you who let Android handle orientation changes, do remember that if Android is handling orientation by itself, it will restart your activity. So if you don't want that to happen, you'll have to handle it manually. And in your activity class, you'll have to say use the onConfiguration change function. And also in the manifest, you have to let Android know that for this activity, you're going to handle orientation changes. The reason I mentioned keyboard here is all those phones which have a slide-out keyboard. So when the keyboard slides out, the phone automatically changes the orientation. So that goes into a landscape mode. So you can either if you use this, So if you handle orientation manually, what you can do is, as soon as orientation changes, and if you have your layout spread across layout portrait and layout landscape, Android will pick and choose your layouts depending on the orientation it is in. Okay, this next, be logical. How many of you still use absolute layouts? Good. Okay, So the point being here that don't go to, absoluteness is not always with layouts. If you're using PX, you're being very absolute in value. Don't use PX in your layouts, because the pixel size actually changes. Like if you have a high DPI screen, your pixels are smaller, right? So a 10 pixel image in one phone will look much smaller than in a bigger phone with lesser resolution. Also, use rules. I'm guessing most of you use relative and linear layouts the most, because you don't use absolute layouts, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So use rules. Like, I'm pretty sure all of you know, put it below this, above that, left, right, align left, align right. Anybody does not know that? Cool. So, but be careful when you're using rules. Like, if you start defining a screen, okay, let's say you have a login screen. Your login screen typically has three components: username, password, and a button, right? So on a phone, if you say align center horizontally, everything will look good. Okay? Now, but if you take that same screen and you put it on a tablet, you'll suddenly have three small buttons going through the center of the screen and a lot of gap on the left and right. So in that case, you probably can be more innovative when it comes to the login screen, and you can actually place it in different places. So whatever you do, make sure you check it on all the screens. I'm going too fast. Okay, now, how many of you use 9 patches? Can some of you tell me what 9 patches are? Anyone? Why is it called 9 patch? Yeah, I can't even make out who's speaking.
There are 9 sections in that image.
Basically what 9 patches are is Android allows you to specify areas of an image you stretch. Now, how many of you don't use 9 patches? So you just use generic image for buttons, right?
Yeah.
So when you turn the phone, your image stretches. It does not look good, right? I think I have a slide for you. Okay, just for understanding purposes, I'll just go that slide and come back over here. Now, most of you, let's say you have a button which says add yellow droid. So, those of you who use images, when your image stretches, it looks like this, right? No?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, so now, okay, coming back to it, this thing. So, what 9 patches basically allow you is it allows you to be specific at which parts of the screen will stretch. So, you see the image on the top, right? It's actually made from the image at the bottom. So basically what we do, is if you can still see me, or I could have used my mouse pointer. Okay, so a nine patch image is basically your a regular image with a 1 pixel transparent border, where on the top and the left you specify the areas where you want the image to stretch, and on the right and the bottom you specify the area. You specify the area where you want your content to stay. So for this image, I've set these 2 pixels on the top. All the pixels in that line will stretch horizontally. Okay, and this pixel, this pixel and this pixel will stretch vertically. And the paint patches, basically where the patches intersect, will stretch in both directions. So I actually have a demo for you guys. Hold on. Where is my patch? Yeah. So Android also provides you a tool, which is basically a draw nine patch, where you can actually take an image and draw nine patches. So let me erase the patches. Okay, I need 3 hands. I'm just going to keep it down. So imagine this was a basic image, right? So we know we don't want to stretch the arrow, okay? But we know we want the arrow on the right, because that's how your UI defines it. Basically, the button will tell you have to go forward somewhere, right? So we'll tell it that I want it to stretch somewhere over here, okay? So we'll tell Android that you can stretch this part of the image on the left, okay? And we just want to stretch 1 pixel above the arrow and 1 pixel below. So basically what then happens is you form a nine. This is actually what I call a 15 patch, because they're more than 9 patches, according to Google's definition. Because what they don't tell you is that your patches need not be they need not be continuous. They can be spread about. So if I take it here, and if I stretch the image, it'll actually tell you how the image is going to look as it stretches. So you see the arrow is not at all changing its size, whereas everything around it is. So you can also use 9 patches for gradients. How many of you use 9 patches for gradients? Cool, I just told you something that all of you don't know. Okay, so although I don't have an example. So basically a gradient, most of the iPhone apps have a gradient, a two-color gradient, where you have a line in the center and the color on the top and the bottom changes, right? So for images like that, you can make the last pixel at the bottom and the last pixel at the top stretch. So your gradient, like, you still have the gradient effect of the image. I'm not boring you, I hope.
No.
So I actually have an example of this running on the emulator. So these are 2 buttons which are running off the same background drawable. So you can see, you can't really make out that they're 2 separate images. The other thing, I don't know if many of you noticed, 9 patches actually make your APK size smaller. And but depending on your image, make sure you have 9 patches for both HDPI and NDPI, and LDPI if you still work on it. I don't personally. So like this arrow, right? You want to give separate image sizes, otherwise you have the same size on the smartphone. You'll have a bigger arrow on the smartphones. Okay, going back to our presentation. Oops. Oh. How many of you use XML drawables? How come? Okay. I think I saw some people raise their hand for XML drawables and not for 9 patches. Maybe just me. Believe me, I'm not drunk. I don't drink. So what basically XML drawables are they allow you to use XML to actually draw images. So you all have used the seek bar, right? Or a progress bar. Internally, Android actually does not have images for it. They are actually XML drawables. So this is a part of an XML drawable of a progress bar. I didn't keep the entire thing because it's a little late. So your XML, your drawables, you can define shapes, you can define corners, you can have gradients. So over here, I've decided that my gradient will have a corner which is rounded by 15 dpi. So if you remember in our emulator screen, these are actually XML images. They are not druggers. I'm not sure about the thumb though. I didn't look at the code. So basically, so the reason I used XML druggers for this is to specify my own background color. Initially, I started off with that. And again, they reduce your APK size, and they will work on all screen sizes. I think I can show you a demo for that here too. Control F12. What's to rotate this? What's the control F12, right? F12. Okay. Demo works. Thank you.
F7.
Control F7. I'll just go with all the control buttons. I don't have a numpad on my laptop.
Function.
Okay, modern won't try that. Okay, so usually this works. Where I can rotate. It's not, so I'm sorry about that. Yeah, so what you can also do is, let's say you have to draw a line. You can actually not use a gradient, okay? And you can use something called as a stroke. You saw the second white color progress bar, right? So that's actually a stroke. So instead of having an image which is a line, you can, of course, you can make it a line patch. But you can also have it, you can stroke it here. But if you're making a stroke, make sure your shape kind of says it's a line. So there are a lot of things you can actually, XML drawables. I can't put everything on one slide. So you can check up the documentation for it. Yeah, how many of you use images on text? Text on images by itself. As in, you ask your UI developer to provide the text on the image. Okay, 2, 3. Number. So, I was kind of doing that when we noticed this happens. Then we decided to have a policy in the company that says your image should not have text unless required. So there are two ways you can separate it, right? You can have a background and you can give a text, but your background will still scale, right? So the way you do it, the best way to do it is actually have backgrounds with the 9 patches. So this image, the 9 patch would be something like this. Although it looks like a circle, what you basically need to do is you need to stretch the pixels right in between. Okay. The next most important thing is testing. By hook or by crook, you have to test on all devices. Okay. Also, when you're designing your layouts, right, using the XML editor, and you have, just make sure you put your true sample data in there. Just don't put QWERT, QWERT, NC. Okay, it looks fine. Put what data is going to be there, because then you know that your screen is going to look like this. Like if you have a number, let's say you have a percentage, right? Your percentage can go from 0 to 100. You put a 0, it looks fine, right? And then you have something that's to the left of that number. But as soon as it moves to 100, I don't know how many people notice this, if you have an image to the right of that number, it will kind of move because the numbers are getting increasing in number of digits, right? So always work with the largest possible numbers. How many of you develop only on the emulator? I'm sorry, but you need to stop doing that. So most of my developers come and tell me, this is working on the emulator, it's not working on the phone. It looks fine on the emulator, it's not working on the phone. So don't trust the emulator. In fact, don't even trust, just if you have one or two devices, you have to make sure the app looks fine on all devices. They're all different, right? Also, the other thing, how many of you use Moto Dev Studio? You guys already know about it. If I remember correctly, Moto Dev Studio gives you 20 hours worth of testing on Motorola devices by using a service called Device Anywhere. It's basically a company which sets up devices across the world, and you can kind of push your app to that device over there, and you can test it. So it's 20 hours a month. It's fairly, it's enough for most of the projects. So Make sure you test those. Make sure you test your apps on all screens, on all devices. Make use of the facilities that you get. Am I asking? I'm sorry?
There's also another facility, like the device anywhere. Just one to call me.
Perfecto mobile?
Yes.
Okay. You have the same idea. Okay, so apparently there's one more company that does this. It's called Perfecto Mobile. So if you're running on the emulator, you don't lose anything, right? Is it free?
No.
It's free.
No. But Nokia is offering device anywhere services for Zindar reach. For free.
But we're Android developers.
But we have a Nokia registration.
Yeah, so if you're still developing on Symbian or planning to develop on Windows, you can use that facility. But yeah, the device anywhere thing gives you 20 hours a month, right, on Android phones. It's free, basically. 20 hours a month, it's free. Any questions?
Any tools that generate, suppose, an icon in all the three resolutions, high,
I call it my UI designer. There's no tool, but you just need to understand, if you have an MDPI image, the same image, you should increase it by 1.5 or 150%, it becomes an HDPI image, and you need to, so let's start off with HDPI and you scale it down.
Is it tool from Google,
Asset
Studio?
Asset Studio? I'm not going to use that, I should probably.
Asset Studio.
You can generate
for all the menu, so the same,
on all sides.
You
can upload your image and give
you. Okay, so there is a tool for that. It's called Asset Studio by Google. So I need to go home and check it out.
Also, like initially what used to happen was we used to create one APK file. Mm-hmm. Where we used to mention what kind of density is it and resolution, etc. Right? And then in the marketplace, you're only allowed to upload one APK under the name of the application that you're hosting it as, right? Calling it as. But of late, recently, Google has introduced in a case in which you can upload multiple APKs under the same name.
I think that's
a great improvement, because now you're not limited. You just create one app and everybody sees the same app on their phone. Now that's no longer the case. You can specifically put in probably 5 APKs under the same name, and the user, whatever phone he has, that APK will get downloaded to his phone.
Although I don't work for Google, I'm pretty sure that functionality is not for supporting screen sizes. It's actually to I don't know why it is that. I'll need to give a better answer. But it's to make sure, let's say a tablet app, if you want a totally different experience in the tablet, that's why you have multiple APKs. I would suggest not using it for sort of supporting different screen sizes. Because the screen sizes are just going to keep increasing, they're going to keep changing. You just can't keep pumping out multiple APKs, right? And Android does provide you the tools to actually put in all those all the different images and resources into one APK. You just use that. That's a better thing to do.
Is the either look and appeal is changed device to device or control layout? Control look and appeal.
I'm sorry, I didn't get your question.
Is the control look and appeal changes device to device? I observe when I develop in the Acer and Proximic platforms, then both look and appeal or control is changed.
Yes, they do change. Like most of the manufacturers, they decide to change the default resources. Mm-hmm. Like on my HTC phone, the list selector, the automatic list selector is green in color. On Samsung, I think it's blue. So yeah, those things do change. The buttons on the HTC are usually black in color. I'm not sure they're in Samsung. But they do change the colors and images, default images.
I can help you with the question. Basically, default styles have been extended by manufacturers and changed. Mm-hmm. But from Ice Cream Sandwich onwards, they have a T equal theme dot hollow, which is going to be the same on any device.
So, repeat. Okay, so as I was saying, manufacturers decided to change the look, right, for their USPs. But from Ice Cream Sandwich, there will be a theme dot hollow, which will remain across all the devices.
Hi, I have a question. Yes. You specify different layouts for different screens as usual.
Yes.
So now, in your code, it might be a stupid question.
Yeah.
In your code, if you just have to, you set the content view to some layout.xml.
Yes.
So you specifying different layouts, how do you keep that the same for all the screens? I mean, you write the code once, right? So the layouts are specified in different folders of the resources. So you keep the same names in all the folders, and Android takes care of using the corresponding ones?
Yeah, Android will take care of which layouts to use. Also, what you can do is, you can use the onConfiguration change function to actually know whenever the configuration changed, and you can get a new configuration.
So you need to again set the content view to that corresponding
layout. Yeah, so if Android is handling it by itself, rather, if you're not handling it manually, Android will restart that activity.
Yeah, if so, you want to avoid that, so I check if the configuration changes to vertical or horizontal and load that corresponding.
Yes, yes. So what you can also do, I did it for one of my screens, I just decided to remove a few components, static components that I'm not going to use. You can just hide them, make more space for screens. Like as I was saying, I decided to remove the header bar from the screen. It's not required, right? On a smaller screen, your data is more important. So just show that. Anything else you can just remove.
Thank you.
Any more question?
Cool. Thank you so much, guys.